started. We're going to get right into derivations right now. I'm going to refer to problem number 14 of take-home exam number 2 right now. We're going to start with a Boussinesq approximation for any of the equations of motion over here. For the zonal acceleration, we can express that as a function of the pressure gradient force, partial minus 1 over rho naught, partial p prime, partial x. We're going to look at the meridional acceleration. dv dt is a function of also pressure gradient in the y direction, minus 1 over rho naught, partial p prime, partial y. And then finally, dw dt, the vertical acceleration resulting from imbalances between the upward pressure gradient force over here, looking at perturbation pressures, plus a term that refers to buoyancy. And you'll see the details of this in the exam number 2. And then part of exam number 2, and I'm effectively giving some hints as you go along for this test, you're going to be using this equation in order to come up with another equation for del squared p prime. And in that process, here's a hint for what you need to be doing. Del dot du dt is equal to, remember, we're going to be covering this dot product as follows over here. We'll express our del operator as partial x for the x component, partial y, partial z. So the individual components of change in the zonal, meridional, and vertical direction dotted with, we'll express this acceleration vector in its individual vector components, du, dt, dv, dt, and dw, dt, like this. And then in the exam, you're going to continue this expression with this dot product all the way out using these terms over here in order to solve for del squared p prime. And that is what is going to be a big derivation on examination number 2. And when you proceed from this particular point in problem 15 of exam number 2, you're going to be given a linearization problem. Effectively, you'll be decomposing the horizontal and vertical components of motion into a mean part of the profile as well as a perturbation part. And that perturbation part is associated with convective scale motions, effectively deviations from the mean wind profile, a mean vertical motion profile. And the expressions that we used in order to perform this linearization problem are as follows. The total u component of motion, which is a function of x, y, z, t, is equal to some background mean flow, which is a function of height in the zonal direction u bar of z, plus perturbation components u prime x, y, z, t. And then the same general idea for the meridional component of motion, v bar of z plus v prime of x, y, z, t. And then finally, our vertical component of motion will assume that outside of our thunderstorm updrafts and downdrafts, there is absolutely no mean vertical motion, 0 plus w prime of x, y, z, t. So effectively, w bar is equal to 0, which would be something consistent with a background environmental assumption of hydrostatic balance. So we're having no acceleration starting with net 0 vertical motion in the background environment, but the total velocity is going to be incorporating the perturbation velocities owing to convective scale processes. And so because of this particular type of profile, both in the horizontal and vertical, a bunch of terms that you'll be deriving from this del dot du dt, solving for del squared p prime, terms like partial u bar, partial x, partial u bar, partial y. Well, since u bar and v bar both are only functions of z, the horizontal derivatives over here are going to go to 0. A term like partial w bar, partial y is also going to be 0. Since w bar is 0, u bar and v bar are only functions of height. So a bunch of terms are going to go to 0 for, so keep this all in mind for exam number 2. A lot of hints there. And what you'll show in the exam is the following, and I'm going to write this all out over here. You're going to find that del squared p prime is equal to minus rho naught partial u prime partial x squared plus partial v prime partial y squared plus partial w prime partial z squared. That's going to refer to one particular physical phenomenon. And then we're going to have another term, minus rho naught times 2 partial u prime partial y partial v prime partial x plus 2 partial u prime partial z partial w prime partial x plus 2 partial v prime partial z partial w prime partial y. And then we're going to have, so we have all these perturbation velocities over here in both of these terms. Then we're going to have a third term that is going to involve mean components of horizontal motion, minus rho naught times 2 partial u bar partial z partial w prime partial x plus 2 partial v bar partial z partial w prime partial y. And then one final term, partial rho naught partial b partial z. All right. So lots of steps skipped here that you'll be doing in exam number 2. So you'll see, you will actually find out exactly why these terms come together the way that they do in exam number 2. So we're going to talk about the physical implications of each of these terms and explain why they are related to these physical concepts that they do. So this first term over here is going to be what we call, in this case, the hydrodynamic nonlinear, and you can see that over here as we're dealing with all of these prime terms squared, prime terms squared, prime terms squared. So nonlinear perturbation pressure. Since the left-hand side is the perturbation pressure, remember we're going to treat this del squared as two derivatives in order to get back a negative p prime. So we're looking at the hydrodynamic nonlinear perturbation pressure associated with fluid extension. All right, and then we're going to proceed with this next term over here. This term over here is going to be the same. I'll just abbreviate over here, hydrodynamic nonlinear p prime over here associated with shear effects. So the only thing that distinguishes these two terms over here, both are hydrodynamic nonlinear terms. We have prime times prime, so we're dealing with nonlinear terms over here, both describing perturbation pressure. So effectively, what I mean by perturbation pressure are changes in the pressure distribution owing associated with those convective scale motions, which we'll talk about more. This is related to fluid extension, stretching, contraction, essentially. This is associated with the vertical shear profile, the effect of the vertical shear profile, which we'll talk about in a little bit. So fluid extension associated with shear over here. Likewise, over here is the hydrodynamic. This is the hydrodynamic. In this case, we have u bar times w prime. So we're not dealing with a w prime and u prime or v prime and w prime multiplied together. We have a u bar, a mean velocity component multiplied by w prime. So we're dealing with hydrodynamic linear perturbation pressure over here. And we'll talk about the physical implications of this in a little bit. And then this last term over here is what we'll call the non-hydrostatic perturbation pressure. And this is effectively deviations from hydrostatic balance. So effectively, when we're talking about how the pressure changes in the convective environment, we can relate that to processes associated with overturning of the background cape. That represents a deviation from hydrostatic balance. That's effectively the manifestation of cape and the related updraft that we get and the associated pressure deficits that occur with that. But then we have all these other things going on in the background that manifest themselves dynamically in vertical motion associated with the convective updraft. And we're going to talk about what's going on in each of these cases and how it relates to supercell storms and why the rotating updraft itself is going to support additional vertical motion beyond that associated with cape. So if you've heard of low cape, strong vertical wind shear environments, we can get pretty powerful updrafts occurring occurring in minimal buoyancy, this only explains a small portion of the lifting that occurs associated with ascent related to free convection once parcels get above the LFC. But when we have a rotating updraft under certain conditions, these other terms can become very important to explain accelerations to the vertical motion beyond what is associated with this over here. So if you want to think of this as cape part and then everything else, which we're going to talk about right now, and you'll see how the nature of a rotating updraft itself is associated with additional lift beyond that associated with cape. So again, we've skimmed over a tremendous part of what you'll be doing in the examination, and I'm just going to kind of make a flow chart here so you can kind of see what's going on with this perturbation pressure and why it's important, which will become more apparent as we go through class. We're going to effectively over here just summarize all this in terms of a flow chart. We have our del squared P prime, which is what you'll be deriving on the examination, can be considered as a component that is dynamic. And when I say dynamic and hydrodynamic, I'm just abbreviating that over here. This is effectively referring to the storm-induced perturbation pressures, which we're calling these hydrodynamic perturbation pressure, in addition to a component over here associated with buoyancy or deviations from hydrostatic balance, or that part that is non-hydrostatic, which I'll abbreviate as P prime B. Again, that's the non-hydrostatic, the deviation from hydrostatic balance, for example, associated with cape. This dynamic part over here, which we're going to be talking about both today, Monday, as well as Wednesday, can be divided into a linear part, P prime associated with linear effects, which is this term over here. And then the nonlinear part, and again, this is all resulting from the Boussinesq equations of motion, starting with the Boussinesq equations of motion and performing this linearization problem. This nonlinear component can be divided into that part over here, and it's, I should say, just to be more specific, this is dynamic linear and dynamic nonlinear. The dynamic nonlinear part over here is going to be associated with P prime dynamic nonlinear, which I'll sometimes abbreviate as NL, associated with fluid extension, that is going to be this term up here, and then also we will have a component of perturbation pressure, dynamic, nonlinear, that is associated with the vertically sheared environment. That's going to be where we're, and this vertical shear, you're going to see, effectively kickstarts a feedback process that supports additional lifting at the convective scale because we have background vertical wind shear in the environment, background horizontal vorticity, which actually manifests itself in stronger ascent once we get a rotating updraft interact with the vertically sheared environment. All right, we're going to start out by talking about that particular term over here, the hydrodynamic nonlinear shear term over here, and talk about what the effects are.